I'm talking today with John Miller-Stephany, the director of To Fool the Eye, currently playing at the Guthrie Theater. John, great to be talking to you this afternoon. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about why Guthrie chose this particular work.
Sure. Picking a season for the Guthrie is actually quite a complicated process, and Joe Dowling, artistic director, chooses what will be done in any given season. And he spends many, many months reading plays, thinking about plays, trying to balance the season. And when he and I were discussing this season, it seemed to me that there was room to do a bit of a wild card, a little bit of a play that was not quite as well known. Mm-hmm. So much of our work focuses on the established classics. And recently, too, we've been doing newer work. But I thought it might be fun to unearth a play that had been forgotten about. Mm-hmm. Knowing how the season was shaping up, that Hedda was going to be part of the season, Hedda Gabler, and also Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, it seemed to me that we could use a comedy
right.
and in the mix.
Right, right.
So I started looking at plays that were lighter, and also plays that had been sort of fallen off the theatrical radar, as it were.
Mm-hmm.
And Joe and I had spoken briefly about a Molière comedy, and we hadn't done a French play in a long time. I thought it was long overdue. The Molières I read, of course, are brilliant plays, but I wasn't tremendously excited about them for one reason or another. And I thought of Jean Anouilh.
Mm-hmm.
And I love the idea of doing one of his plays, because although he is a brilliant playwright, he has sort of fallen out of favor
right.
in the last 20, 30 years.
Right.
So I thought that would be fun, and did a good amount of reading of his work. He was very prolific. He wrote many, many plays,
mm-hmm.
and ran across this comedy called Leocadia that I had never even heard of,
mm-hmm.
and was really smitten with it. It's charming and very funny, with great roles for actors. And there's also an enormous amount of wisdom in the play as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I loved that combination.
Mm-hmm.
And Joe seemed interested in the idea, and I think it fit well within the scheme of the year. There are a couple of existing translations of Leocadia, one done about 13 years ago, and another one done in the 50s by an English woman. That version is called Time Remembered, and that was really quite popular for a brief period in the 50s. Helen Hayes won a Tony Award for her portrayal of the Duchess in Time Remembered on Broadway. But Joe wasn't really particularly, and quite rightly so, enamored of those existing translations, and we tossed around the idea of having someone do a new adaptation.
Mm-hmm.
And that really interested him and interested me as well. So we secured the services of Jeffrey Hatcher, who is a Twin Cities-based playwright,
mm-hmm.
a very, very intelligent guy with a wicked sense of humor, and he seemed absolutely the perfect fit.
And sometimes if you're brought in as an adapter, as I was, not speaking the language, and I should preface this by saying that we did have a very good literal translation done for us by Stephanie Debner. When you come in from the outside, you can look at the literal translation, and you can look at other translations and see, well, here's where they tend to agree about a certain passage, here's where they disagree, here's where there's all sorts of variations, here's where something seems to be completely untranslatable. So then it's my job to sort through all that and say, all right, what is going to work in front of an American audience in the year 2000 here at the Guthrie with this company of actors, with this audience, and what is also going to be faithful enough to the original play so that someone bringing Henri back from the dead wouldn't be horrified to have him sit in the third row.
Theophilus, who brought this fruit? I do not want lemons, I do not want oranges, and I most certainly do not want mangoes. You eat fruit, you lose weight, and you, my pet, cannot afford to lose an ounce. Wouldn't she be stunning, Hector, if she had a hint more heft? Eggs, Parker, Theophilus.
Madame.
Remove this eruption of citrus, and bring forth some eggs, lots and lots of eggs.
No!
No? I don't think I've ever heard that word. Mademoiselle, what means this no?
I'm not hungry, and I never eat eggs.
Precious.
Precious?
Talk a little bit about why this works as a fairy tale, and why what attracted you to this fairy tale milieu in this script.
Especially in the first couple of scenes, there is a very much a Lewis Carroll feel.
Right.
And I very much wanted to embrace the Alice in Wonderland quality. Particularly prevalent in the first couple of scenes.
Right.
There is a once upon a time feeling. We have a handsome, charming prince, you know, with this duchess who's a combination of the Queen of Hearts from Alice in Wonderland and a fairy godmother. So all of that I wanted to embrace. But Ennui was a very clever writer. Mm-hmm. And although he loved the fable form, he really tweaked it too. Ennui was a combination of a romantic and a cynic. And as a cynic, the man really didn't believe in happily ever after. He thought that happily ever after meant that the story was unfinished. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm not nearly as cynical. I happen to believe in that there are happy endings, and I think this play has a wonderful happy ending. But there is a sort of caveat at the end, and there's a twist at the end, which comes directly from Ennui's sensibility. I think the fact that it is has that once upon a time quality that makes it suitable for families, mm-hmm. which is lovely, and it's a really great structure to explore reality versus illusion, mm-hmm. Which is I think a profound exploration in the play, but one that you have to look for it a bit. It's one can actually enjoy the play on the surface, mm-hmm. but audiences also who take the time to think about it realize that there is an enormous amount of wisdom among the wit.
May I ask you a question?
Sweet.
Are you really an ice cream vendor?
Oui.
Do you sell ice cream?
Oh, no.
Did you ever sell ice cream?
Oui.
But you don't sell ice cream?
No.
Thank you very much. I was afraid things were beginning to make sense.
And now Amanda is an interesting character in that she really does develop through this play.
Absolutely, she does.
Can you give us a little sense of what is she like? What is this role like? Can you talk a little bit about some of the dimensions of this character?
She's a great gutsy gal in the tradition of the 1930s, screwball heroines of Claudette Colbert and John and I, when we were having character discussions at the beginning of rehearsal, mm-hmm. Kind of agreed that there was something very archetypal about her. Is mm-hmm. that how I say it? Did I say that right? Archetypal?
Archetypal.
Anyway. But she's a working girl. And she comes to this insane world and gets pulled about by it and then gets drawn into it, mm-hmm. and then manages to kind of take it on her own terms.
Right,
and I think it's really exciting.
Right.
Well, what do you think? A little disturbing, huh?
Oh, spooky!
The very word for which I have searched in vain since yesterday evening. Spooky! Where did you find this word?
The newspapers?
Ah, well, there it is. I never read. Still, it's the right word. Spooky.
It's a little chilly in here.
She's funny, too. We laugh a lot. Don't fret, my dear. You may seem spooky to us, but in truth, you are a... What is she, Hector? A Renoir? A Renoir that walks.
Fredona.
Bish bosh! She's not a bit rococo.
Mademoiselle Leopagia was not one for wiggling.
Where was the light that lit the room?
Oh, almost! Do it on your own,
it is an insane, crazy, but delightful world. And the play starts in one place and goes to kind of a different area. But it's...
You have the wonderfully mad Duchess played by Barbara Brin.
Who is extraordinary.
Extraordinary. Now the relationship with Albert, the prince, Can you talk about how that grows? Because Amanda's sort of, she's sort of a little bit lost, or she's uncertain. She's this sort of the shop girl character. But she starts, there's certain transformations occur to her, particularly in the relationship with Albert. Can you talk about when she first sees Albert and how that transformation begins to happen in her character?
Sure. I think at the very beginning, the attraction is pretty superficial. He's just an incredibly good-looking young man.
Right.
And I think he's a difficult person. He's very prickly. I mean, the great thing about this love story is it's not a perfect love story. This is not a perfect prince. This is a prince who has a ferocious temper, kind of terrifying ego, but he's also got this wonderful charisma and charm, and he's so beautifully brought to life by Scott that I think that really comes through. And I think that she begins to actually have a great deal of sympathy for his pain.
Right.
And then I think she genuinely falls in love with him
over
the course of it, and decides, you know, it's a great reversal of the typical fairy tale in that she gets to save him at the end. And
no. Oh, excuse me.
What?
I forgot.
What?
I touched your hand.
So?
She hated to be touched.
By?
Anyone without exception.
Including you?
Especially me. She said I had the grasp of a monkey. Rough hands disturbed her.
Rough?
Well, I have calluses. Yachting, tennis, polo, what are you doing?
Comparing the differences between a worker's calluses and the calluses of a man of leisure.
So what is the difference?
Choice.
You have calluses?
Mm-hmm. See? Not hard.
Isn't he like thinking about committing suicide towards the end?
That's what the Duchess certainly tells her, and whether that's the Duchess's ploy to really reel her in and get her to play Leocadia for the next few days, or whether that's real.
I think.
But I think the pain is absolutely real. I think he's a tormented soul.
Right, right. One of the things I really liked about the way the story is written is that Leocadia, the opera singer, it seems shallower and more silly and trivial, and this sort of, and the way the Amanda's character confronts the prince with the whole play is about illusion and transformations, mm-hmm. about with constantly playing roles, etc. The way Amanda confronts the prince with how superficial is his idea of Leocadia and how superficial is his commitment to his love for her. Can you talk a little bit about that theme of what is real love and what is just play acting at love?
Well, I think that it's, rather than necessarily being superficial, I think it's a dogmatic love. It's love that clings on for the sake of clinging, and it's deeply felt. But he has a wonderful speech about, there's the kind of love that knows ease and basks in the sun, and then there's another kind of love that transfixes and transforms but has little to do with happiness. And mm-hmm. I think the message of the play is really about practical love versus heroic love, and that heroic love often doesn't lead to happiness and is not necessarily bound to the real and the to-be-lived-in moment. It's really a head love.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that Amanda is able to kind of bring him back to the earth and to show him another way.
But Leocadia never said to him.
Never said, I know. She's a horrible, horrible person.
But it's wonderful. This picture,
you realize that she's just a nightmare of a person.
Right. And it's wonderful emphasis on how vacant she was.
Oh,
she's so vacuous. It's wonderfully, this wonderfully vacuous, trivialized sort of caricature of character that he's devoted himself to. It's great stuff. Yeah. Is she in the, because there's like roles within roles, there's a line about that's not in the plot when she runs off into the garden, right, so to speak. There's a great line where there's no end to this garden, she's been running around.
I know.
Where does this garden end? There's no end to it. That's very funny. But can you talk about how she's, I mean, does she try and play act and then does she kind of stop, or is she never really play acting in her role?
I think she gives Leocadia a good go, and I think a lot of that happens off, you know, the 2 days previous to the evening that you see. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I mean, the middle of the play is the evening where mm-hmm. the veneer cracks and mm-hmm. she kind of comes through. Mm-hmm. But definitely, she's given Leocadia a good attempt, and I think done extremely well.
Right.
Trying to be her and trying to play that role as best she can.
I have to leave.
Leave? Why?
Because I can't beat her.
Who?
You know who I mean. I don't care about her. I want you to understand that. I don't care about her. In my heart, I know that I am stronger than she ever was. But she has more power than I.
She may be powerful, but she has the practical disadvantage of being dead.
She didn't even let him touch her hand. His hands are not hard. They're his hands. Simple hands. Hands made to take and to touch. If only he'd listen to them. But he doesn't listen to his hands, and he doesn't listen to me. He listens to her, and since she's dead, she cannot be contradicted.
You are in love, my dear. That gives you more power than anything in the whole world. Look around you. Stop crying and look. The night is over. It's morning now.
Your hands are strong hands. You should listen to them. They're saying, let the memory go. Hands love, and then one day, you wake up strangers. They're only hands to say hello with and brush your hair. Nothing more. And that's good. Put your hands on me, please.
If I touch you, I will love you. And I don't want to touch you.
Yesterday you were the prince. Today you're a fish struggling against the current. Against the whole force of the world rushing down on you.
Leocadia.
Love. Put your hands on my hips.
Well, one of my main responsibilities as an associate artistic director here at the Guthrie is casting.
Right.
I'm the point person for all casting.
Right.
So it's something that I enjoy enormously. Mm-hmm. And with this play in particular, I thought there were opportunities to really do some unusual casting.
When
I read this play initially, Barbara's name just, you know, leapt off the page.
It's
almost as if Anoui had seen her on stage and said, Barbara, I'm going to write you a part next season.
Right.
It's a part that has character actresses have had great fun with.
Right.
Margaret Rutherford, English character actress, played it in the West End in the 50s. Mm-hmm. Helen Hayes won a Tony Award for it. It's a wonderful part. And it's one of the reasons why I wanted to do the play, was for Barbara, to have her play this part.
Right.
And then the prince and Amanda are interesting because they're not your drippy, juvenile, and mindless ingenue.
Right.
They're actually, there's some meat there.
Right.
Fortunately, Scott Farrar, who plays the prince, became available. He's worked at the Guthrie a couple of times. He's based out of New York.
Mm-hmm.
And he was doing an off-Broadway play that closed shortly before he went into rehearsal. So he became available. In many ways, he's ideal because he almost looks like he's stepped out of a of a storybook. You know, he's right. tall and handsome, and he looks like Prince Charming.
Right.
But Scott is also a classical actor, and he really taps into the, you know, the darkness, the neurosis of this guy. He's really, in many ways, he's a tragic character, and he's the character is psychologically has been stinted at one point in his growth. And Scott really understood that. Melinda Page Hamilton, who is an incredible actress, just came to us out of a cold audition in New York. And she did a spectacular job, and it's one of those leaps of faith when you see an actress and you think, wow, I think she could you know, really shine in this. And fortunately, I knew of her background in terms of her training and such. And she's, you know, in my world, I think Melinda is a find. Some of the cameo roles, where it was great fun to think in terms of the Twin Cities pool of talent, because we have an enormous amount of talent in the Twin Cities, and trying to figure out, you know, who would shine in these quirky little roles. The head waiter and the butler require two men with enormous comic skills. Jim Lickscheidl is an actor we've hired frequently over the last couple of years, and he cut his teeth at the Brave New Workshop. He's very, very familiar with broad physical comedy, and I think in just a genius. And I was thinking, who in the Twin Cities could match that? You know, who has the sort of the larger than life sense, and who's really comfortable with physical comedy? And of course, I've been going to lots of local theater, and I thought of Stephen from Jun Loon. And I once again called him out of the blue and said, Stephen, I'm doing this play, and do you happen to be free in the fall? And is this something that would interest you? So happily, you know, he was available, and those two guys, I think, are, you know, perfectly matched. There's this funny little guy, this ice cream vendor, and I thought, well, you know, that really deserves, it's called To Fool the Eye, and we have to start thinking outside the box. Who in the Twin Cities would, you know, would the audience be surprised to see on the Guthrie stage, who is sort of a kindly old guy who, and of course, Dudley Riggs, I thought, this is, you know, this is a great opportunity. Maybe Dudley would be available and interested. So that's the type of thinking that went into it.
One of the great themes that runs through this show, sort of brings great sparkle to the script, is this whole idea of play. You're going to play the role, and you know that's not in the plot when she runs off and Amanda runs off to the garden. I wonder if you can talk about that whole issue of using theater to explore role playing and using it in such a way that it's not just just a trite moral to the story, but sort of as really does add energy to the storytelling. I wonder if you can talk about that theme of role playing and illusion in the theatrical context for this production.
Right. I know we loved the idea of theater as play. As a young person, he spent a lot of time in the theater watching operettas. His mother was a musician, and so that sort of larger than life confection became second nature to him. He was exposed to it at an early age. He loved that idea. In fact, the French are, you know, somewhat obsessed with the idea of or the theme of illusion versus reality. You look at Molière and how the commedia was embraced by the French theater. It's really part and parcel of their culture. So it's it comes, you know, directly from the source. But Jeff did have a good bit of fun, Jeff Hatcher, playing up on those themes, and I think it really works beautifully that he chose to enlarge the idea of the illusion versus reality in a theatrical sense, and it's so true. It's what, when, you know, what are our perceptions? What is real? What is unreal? It turns out that, of course, Amanda is genuinely much more pleasing than the original. In the play, which I think is, which is a wonderful thought, you know.
But I think certain attitudes about class, for example, and politics, are hard to translate for us, or at least hard to accept, and so we massage things like that. Obviously, there are certain punchlines that probably had them rolling in the aisles back in the late 30s in Paris that I'm absolutely certain that you would stare, you know, dumbfounded at. This evening. Well, you might stare at this dumbfounded anyway. But it's our job to try to make those things work and say, well, here in the ennui, there was a joke and it was about this. And here in this version, there is a joke and it is about this, but it's not the same joke. So that in large part has been the work over, I guess, the last 6 months that we've been working on the script. So when I tend to think of ennui in later life, I think of a much more serious playwright, you know? It's like the Beckett kind of plays are up on a pedestal, where here he's throwing all sorts of things together in the mix and trying to get that mix right so that it's not jarring is part of the deal too. But I think actually it may be a little easier for us to take now than it would have been, say, 20 years ago. What with all the postmodern stuff of the last 15, 20 years, I think you can get away with mixing sadness and giddiness and tragedy and death and all that sort of thing. So I think maybe this is just the right time for an adaptation like this. At least we hope so.
I have written a musical version of Ennui's Thieves' Carnival, and thoroughly enjoyed that experience, and so I was delighted to have the opportunity to work on another Ennui play. Ennui wrote almost for a composer. In other words, the comedy is so musical. I think someone said it's very lyrical. It's very easy to write for his work. The structure of the music, or the template that I used for the musical structure, there's a line mentioned by where the Duchess says she has seen the rise of the Impressionists, and so I took that as my cue, and the music underscoring is all based on a whole tone scale, which if any of you are musicians, the Debussy, Ravel tended to gravitate toward the whole tone scale, which a device used by the Impressionists, the French Impressionists. The gypsy music is not. The gypsy music is sort of faux gypsy music. But
to fool
the ear. That's right.
The term, to fool the eye, is a loose translation of the French term trompe l'oeil, right? I don't know if I'm pronouncing it correctly. Basically, you know, you stand 12 feet away and you see a beautiful row of books, and then you get close and you realize that the books are all painted onto a wall, but from a certain distance they were gorgeous.